Hello friends, a very good morning to all of you. Myself, Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. And this is the video of morning tales that can be of use for you guys if you are appearing for RBI SEBI NABARD examinations. So this video particularly caters to the need of phase 1 current affairs. Also, if you are appearing for any kind of banking examination at the level of PO, then also the questions that I'm going to discuss can be of use for you guys. So let's begin this video. But before that, if you are coming here for the first time, then do not forget to subscribe and hit the bell notification. Also, you can join this Telegram group, which can help you directly connect with us, and also here we provide you with free quizzes, and the link of this group is in description below. So if you want to join this group, then you can join this group through that link. Now this is the RBI Grade B 2022 course. In this new course, we have PDFs, videos and mocks. Apart from this, we also conduct mock interviews for your interview preparation. And the bonus here is that you will get a book kit, and that book kit will contain all the books mentioned here. Right now we are running a 30% discount on this course. So if you want to avail that discount, you can use this RBI 30 coupon code. Also, this is the number where you can call us if you have any queries. Okay. So let's discuss our first question of the day. With which country has India signed 3-year work program agreement for development in agriculture cooperation? So we have Israel, Japan, Germany, Italy and United Kingdom. Out of these 5 options, the right answer here is Israel. So with Israel, this agreement has been signed. So let me tell you that under this agreement, Indo-Israel agricultural project center of excellence as well as in the Israel villages of excellence will be promoted and will be basically leveraged. So this Indo-Israel agriculture project center of excellence as well as villages of excellence are the prototype or the model of centers that have been established under this program. Now I am saying that they have been established. That means that this program is nothing new. This Indo-Israel agricultural program was in place since 2008, and this agreement is nothing but an extension of that program. So in 2008, India and Israel signed an agreement for establishing Indo-Israel agricultural project, and at that time it was a 3-year agreement. But in 2012, when the 3 years completed, this agreement was further extended till 2015, and under that agreement only Indo-Israel agricultural project center of excellence was established. And now the work on their capacity building is going to be done under this 3-year agreement that has been signed recently by India and Israel. So that was all about this Indo-Israel agreement in the agriculture sector. Now, if you are talking about the national sector, the entire nation, because this definitely caters to the entire nation, I have one more news to discuss with you guys. And that news is about the proposed national mission on use of biomass in coal-based thermal power plants. So let's discuss some things about that. So this national mission on use of biomass in coal-based thermal power plants is basically a proposed plan of Ministry of Power. So this mission is basically at its proposal stage right now, because this is going to be set up by Ministry of Power, remember that. Now the proposed timeline of this mission is expected to be 5 years, and the purpose of this mission is clear from its name itself, that is the mission on use of biomass in coal-based thermal power plants. So basically, in simple terms, this mission aims to increase the use of biomass in thermal power plants that are currently operating because of coal. So in order to remove coal or reduce the usage of coal in thermal power plants, this mission is going to be launched by Ministry of Power. So that is one thing about this mission. But the second point here is important. That is the objective that this national mission aims to achieve. And that objective is to reduce the carbon emissions and to reduce the entire climate change. So that is the one basic fact behind this national mission. But still, this mission is not implemented, therefore we do not know about the operationality or the guidelines related to this mission. But as and when these guidelines will be released by the government, I am going to tell you it in the video itself. Okay, so that was all about this mission. Now moving on to the second question. Where is Kuno National Park located? Karnataka, Chhattisgarh, West Bengal, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra. Out of these 5 options, the right answer here is D. Now guys, this is not at all a static question that I'm asking you. This is a very, very, very much current affairs question. Why? Because recently, the central government has announced to relocate cheetahs from South Africa to Kuno National Park. You should also be aware of this fact that cheetah, the world's fastest running animal on land, has been declared extinct in India since 1952. So we do not have cheetahs on our land. And this is going to be the first time that cheetahs are going to be transported from one continent to another. Now guys, you should also be aware of this fact that in January 2020 only, Supreme Court had approved the transportation of cheetahs from Africa to India. And at that point of time, the Supreme Court has formed a committee of 3 members to assist National Tiger Conservation Authority so that it can help in relocating the cheetahs from Africa to this Kuno National Park in Madhya Pradesh. So that was all about the news related to this Kuno National Park, and that is why this question is important, because this is in the news because of the cheetahs. So remember that it is in Madhya Pradesh. My question from you is that you have to name the other national parks of Madhya Pradesh in the comment section below. Okay, moving on to the next question. Which sector received the highest FDI inflow in 2020-2021 as per the Ministry of Commerce and Industry data? So we have coal and fertilizer, computer software and hardware, steel, crude oil and natural gas, petroleum refinery products in the options. Out of these, the right answer is option B. Computer software and hardware is a sector that has received the maximum FDI inflow in 2020-2021, the year of coronavirus pandemic. Now let us discuss some facts related to this news. So this data is released by Ministry of Commerce and Industry, and according to this data, India has attracted its highest ever total FDI inflow of US$81.72 billion in 2020-2021. Now guys, this is 10% higher as compared to the last financial year, 2019-2020. So this is again amazing that in the pandemic times also, India was able to attract this much FDI, which was the highest ever total FDI India has received till now. Okay, the next point is FDI equity inflow. Remember that the word equity is mentioned here. Equity inflow grew by 19% in the 2020-2021 year as compared to the previous year. Highest FDI inflow came from Singapore, followed by USA and Mauritius. So this is usually the scenario if you take another report as well on FDI inflow in India. So Singapore has remained the topmost destination from where FDI inflows has come in India. Next point is that computer software and hardware received the highest FDI inflow, followed by construction sector as well as services sector. And Gujarat is the topmost FDI recipient in terms of states in the same year, 2020-2021, followed by Maharashtra and Karnataka. So these were some facts related to FDI inflows in India provided by Ministry of Commerce and Industry that you should remember. Next question is, who has become the first female PM of Samoa? So this is a country in Oceania. Remember that. This is a part of Oceania continent. Now you have the 5 options right in front of you. Let me tell you the answer of this question. The right answer is option D. That is Naomi Matafa. So she is the first female prime minister of Samoa. Now, as you can see, this is a very basic question. There is nothing much that we can discuss here. But my question is remaining. The question is the capital and currency of this country that you are going to tell me in the comment section below. Next question is again a very simple question. When is the International Week of Solidarity with the People of Non-Self-Governing Territories observed? So it is observed in the month of May from 25th to 31st. And remember, this week is observed by United Nations. So United Nations approved the observation of this week, International Week of Solidarity. So that was all about this question. Now it's time that we can say goodbye to each other. Thank you so much for watching the